Hey folks, I'm Alex DeBrie, and today we're going to talk about using DynamoDB with your GraphQL API. Now, a lot of DynamoDB advice recommends using single table design for your DynamoDB applications, and there's some debate about how well that works with GraphQL. In this video, we're going to show how to use single table design with your GraphQL API. The key trade-off to know here is this is going to add a little bit more complexity in your resolvers, but you're going to have better performance on your queries. So we're going to build this using AWS AppSync. I'm going to show the key points in the AWS console, but if you want to see how this is done using infrastructure as code, go ahead and check out the repo that's accompanying this project. Now, before we get started, I just want to talk about the guiding application that we're going to use for this example. Imagine we have some sort of SaaS blog hosting platform, right? So users can come in, they can set up a site. So we have a site entity in our application. Once they've created a site, they can blog on that site, add lots of different posts. So there's a one-to-many relationship between sites and posts. Also, when other users and readers come and look at those posts, they can comment on those posts if they want. So we have a one-to-many relationship between posts and comments. Now, the key point here is even though we have three separate entities, they're all going to be going into that single DynamoDB table that we're going to be using for this application. All right, the first thing we're going to do is create that DynamoDB table. So head to the DynamoDB section of the AWS console and click that Create Table button to get started. We need to give our table a name. Since we're just using a single table here, we'll just give it a name like, you know, AppSync single table or something. And then we need to choose the primary key for our table. Since we're using single table design, we'll use that generic PKSK values for our partition key and our short key there. We'll keep most of the settings the same. The only thing we want to change here is go to on-demand mode, so we don't really need to worry about our capacity for this, and scroll down and hit that Create Table button. We'll just give it a second and wait for our table to be created, and as soon as it's created, we can go on and create our AppSync API. To do that, we want to head to the AWS AppSync section of the AWS console. Go there and click that Create API button. There are a few different wizards and guides, ways we can set up our schema, but we already have a schema, so we'll just do the build from scratch option and click start. Next thing we need to do is give our API a name, so we'll give it the name single table blog and hit that create button. So now we've created our API, what we need to do is edit our schema. So let's click that edit schema button and we'll just paste in our schema that we already have defined for that. I want to take a quick look at that. You know, you can see the schema root, which has both query and mutation on it. Within our query, you can see we have a few different top level queries, get site, get post for site, things that are going to be common in our application. We also have the different mutations that we'll have, create site, create post, create comment, things like that. Additionally, we have all of our types defined. You can hit save schema to save that schema to your API. One last thing I want to do here, head over to data sources and we're going to register our DynamoDB table that we created, right? So we create our DynamoDB table, we want to register it for use here. We'll give it a name of DynamoDB table and indicate that it's of type DynamoDB table. We'll look up the region that we created it in and then we should be able to see our AppSync single table table. Once you've done that, hit that create button and you're good to go. You've now registered your table within your API and you can use it in a resolver. Let's go create one of these resolvers now. So what I want to do is head back to my schema that I've already entered. And if you look at your schema on the right-hand side, there's a resolvers section where you can attach different resolvers to different fields in your schema. I'm going to scroll down to the mutation resolver and do that create site, sort of the top level resolver in my application. I'll configure a data source. And because I'm going directly to a DynamoDB table, I'll use what's called VTL templates. So this is a templating language to interact directly with my DynamoDB table. If you don't like VTL, you can use a Lambda function directly instead and work with your DynamoDB table that way. But I'm gonna be working with VTL in this particular example. So I'll paste in both the request mapping and the response mapping. One thing, if you look at the request mapping, just notice the key we're using there. We're using PK and SK for that primary key value for our item. We also have a type attribute. These are common DynamoDB single table design principles here. So we'll just do that. We'll save this resolver here and we've configured our first resolver on our DynamoDB table. I want to set up one more resolver for our schema because it's a little more complex and it's going to show off that single table design. So let's go down and find our site type in our schema. You can see that it has some properties, ID, name, domain, but it also has this post property, which is of type post connection, which is going to include a cursor plus a post array of other posts. So what that includes is if someone comes and gets our site, they can also fetch the posts with it. We're going to show how to use single table design with our GraphQL schema here. So let's go set up our get site resolver here. We'll find that query and attach a resolver, so DynamoDB table. Again, we have to do that request mapping template, response mapping template. I'm gonna put in the request mapping template here. One thing to note is just look at the top there. We're doing some interesting work where we're looking at the selection set list. So this is basically saying, what attributes are they looking at in this particular resolver? And if it contains posts, we're gonna fetch more items. We're gonna fetch 11 items, so the site plus 10 posts. Whereas if we're fetching just the site, then we'll just get that one site item. Likewise, let's go down into the response mapping template section down here. This is complex as well. You know, at the beginning, we're saying, hey, if we don't get anything back, we'll just return that. But if we do get some items back, now we need to iterate through that result set and sort of deserialize those, figure out what they are. If it's a site, we'll set that as our site item. If it's of type post, we'll add it to this posts array. And then later on, we'll add those posts to our site as an attribute, include both the cursor and those posts, and then return it back to our calling client. So again, the VTL is a little more complex here, but you can still use those single table principles with AppSync, with GraphQL and DynamoDB. I'm gonna set the rest of the resolvers up on my own time, but there's one last thing I wanna do. Let's set up XRay on our GraphQL API. So go to settings, and then you can scroll down and click enable XRay and save those settings. And what XRay is gonna give you is just visibility into what's happening on a particular request. So you can see all the different resolvers that were hit, all the different APIs that were called as part of a request. All right, with XRay configured, with all our resolvers set up, it's time to actually run some queries. So let's go over to the left-hand side here, click that queries button. And what this is, inside AppSync, you get a little query browser that you can run some queries directly in there. So the first thing we wanna do is create our first site. We'll do that create site mutation and just create a blog for awsamazon.com. So we'll send that in. We were able to create that site. But a site is only as good as the posts that are on it. So let's create a few posts as well. We'll use that create post mutation there using that AWSAmazon.com domain and send in our first blog post. Hey, hooray, that succeeded. We got one blog post in there. Let's do one more blog post because we don't want to have just one as we're showing this. So let's get a second blog post in there. We have our second post. This was able to create a second post. So now we've created these things, let's actually query them back. And that's where we're gonna see the power of this single table design. We'll do a get site query here, and let's just look at the structure of that query, right? It's a multi-level query where we're doing that get site operation and getting that site back. But as part of that, we're also fetching the posts that are related to that, right? So we have a one-to-many relationship, multiple levels of entities, and you can see it returned all that data back to us in a pretty quick and snappy and responsive way. So now that we've seen that, let's see what actually happened on that last query because we get to see the magic of single table design here. So let's head to XRay, and it's got a few different traces in here. We're gonna find that the most recent one to see our last query and just click on that particular trace. If you scroll down to the bottom, you can see all the different requests that were happening as part of that. And if you look in that, it only makes one request to DynamoDB. So even though we're getting two different types of entities, our site entity, our post entity, only making one request, it's also a pretty quick operation. This is about half the time that that same operation, that same GraphQL query took in our multi-table post. So it's quicker there because it's only making that single request to DynamoDB. I think this was able to show some of the trade-offs of using single table design with your GraphQL API. You know, on the one hand, it added some complexity to our resolvers as we have to do lookaheads in our queries to see what fields they're fetching. We also have to do some additional parsing of that DynamoDB query result to deserialize into the different item types. On the other hand, our response had much lower latency than doing it in a multi-table sequential approach. You need to think about what's best for your needs and apply the right design patterns. Be sure to check out the same application using multiple DynamoDB tables for comparison. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed it.